Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the minister, our chief guest for today, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to all of you to the National Conference on Sanitation. Towards Swachh Bharat, creating demand and building partnerships. To begin with the program, may I invite Ms. Shefali Chaturvedi, Senior Director CII and CEO CII Foundation, to give the opening remarks.
Good morning, everybody. Shri Venkaiah Naidu ji, Honorable Minister of Urban Development, Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation and Parliamentary Affairs, Mr. Ajay Sriram, Past President CII, Dr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta, President and Chief Executive Center for Policy Research, friends from industry, civil society, and the media, and the government officials who are here with us today. A very good morning to you. On behalf of CII and the Director General of CII, may I extend a very warm and special welcome to all of you to the National Conference on Sanitation, an initiative of CII in partnership with the Center for Policy Research. I'm especially privileged to welcome Shri Venkaiah Naidu ji, Honorable Minister, on this occasion. We have had the honor of working closely with you, sir, on a range of issues pertaining to the growth of the private sector and overall development of the country, and also have had the benefit of your guidance on significant matters. We thank you for gracing the occasion. The inspiration for this conference has been the call for Swachh Bharat made by the Honorable Prime Minister last year, where he espoused the need of Clean India and launched a massive mass movement that sought to engage everyone in the task of cleaning homes, workplaces, villages, cities, and surroundings in a collective quest. This included creation of provision of toilets in government schools, particularly for girl students, and the corporate sector was specially called upon to take the responsibility as part of their CSR. The Swachh Bharat has been very clearly aligned with the CII's development agenda. We have always been alert to the needs of the corporate sector engagement in public and community interests, targeting the triple bottom line of people, planet, and profit. CII's forged partnerships and developed platforms with the government and civil society to address a range of issues critical to the development of the country. The CII theme this year, Build India, Invest in Development, a Shared Responsibility, reflects this intent. One of the major steps towards development has been the setting of the CII Foundation that works towards inclusive development by providing a meaningful bridge between the marginalized communities and donors, especially the corporate sector. The CII Foundation has undertaken a spectrum of initiatives towards assisting companies in their CSR activities, and we have specially led in the sanitation and schools through a Mission SOS initiative under the Swachh Bharat Swachh Vidyalay initiative. The Mission SOS has seen active involvement of a number of industry members in making Swachh Vidyalay a reality. As per the data collated by CII till August, the private sector had constructed over 4,000 toilet blocks in government schools, and CII itself has constructed 200 toilet blocks in schools in 3 states. Having said that, there's a lot that still needs to be done, which the CII members and the industry is still working on, and we have a target that by March of 2016, this number should increase manifold. I'm pleased to share that as the next phase, CII will now focus on addressing sanitation challenges of urban communities through industry engagements. Additionally, CII, through its various verticals and centers of excellence, has been facilitating the delivery of the Swachh Bharat mission in the form of evangelizing sanitation among members across the country, providing advisory services, promoting waste management technologies, and undertaking projects. The CII Andhra Pradesh government-partnered Andhra Pradesh Technology Development Promotion Center APTDC is one such unique initiative which has now become a pioneer in the country for establishing public-private partnership for technology development and promotion, technology upgradation, and technology commercialization of waste management. Here, I would also like to share that CII has very recently set up a national mission on smart cities with an objective to act as a facilitator and a thought leader to assist the government in the development of 100 smart cities. The aim is to create a knowledge repository on smart cities, which includes expertise sharing and technology developments, successful global case studies, engagement agreements, solutions, white papers, reports, etc. Besides, the mission aims to work with its various national and international institutions in devising key frameworks for the development and execution of smart cities. As we complete 1 year of the Swachh Bharat mission, we felt it is the right time to take stock of the experiences and share them, deliberate on the issues, and draw out an effective course of action to make Swachh Bharat a reality. Friends, today's deliberations will focus on four aspects. One, scope and opportunities in the sanitation sector as an emerging economy. Second, good practices and models which are replicable and scalable, especially in the area of O&M, and interventions leading to behavior change. Three, possibilities of stakeholder engagement and recognize areas of partnerships and collaborations. And four, policies and institutional frameworks that can enable and strengthen efforts towards effective and prompt delivery of the mission. We have an impressive lineup of speakers today representing the government, private sector, multilateral institutions, and social enterprises. Thank you all for sparing your time and joining us here today. I look forward to today's deliberations and welcome you all to actively participate in the discussions. Thank you.
May I now invite Mr. Ajay Sriram, immediate past president CII and chairman and senior managing director DCM Sriram Limited, to give his address, please.
Honorable Minister Shri Venkaiah Naidu, Dr. Bhanu Pratap Mehta, members on the dais, dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of CII and on my own personal behalf, a very warm welcome to all of you to this important event today. The presence of Mr. Venkaiah Naidu at this event is an indicator of the commitment that the Government of India gives to Swachh Bharat. Mr. Naidu is well known for his dedication to rural development, and now he brings the same passion to the Urban Development Ministry with the launch of Smart Cities. Since our topic today cuts across both urban and rural areas, I feel Mr. Venkaiah Naidu is aptly suited to give us a perspective on how to take forward Swachh Bharat. CII is also privileged to collaborate with the Center for Policy Research as they bring insights through their rigorous research work. We're very happy to have with us Dr. Mehta for this program. The challenge of sanitation and open defecation that faces this country is huge, and we all know that. Let me highlight some facts to put it in perspective. Most people worldwide who defecate in the open live in India. Open defecation has dire circumstances. It kills babies, impedes the physical and cognitive development of surviving children, and reduces the human capital of India's workforce. As the rest of the world steadily eliminates this, this behavior stubbornly persists in India. With 67% of rural households and 13% of urban households defecating in the open as per the census of 2011, India now accounts for 60% of the world's open defecation situation. It is particularly threatening for health because of the high population density. As a comparison, the figures for sub-Saharan Africa is 25%, it is 23% for Pakistan, 3% for Bangladesh, and just 1% for China. We therefore need to address this problem urgently, and I must compliment the present government for taking on this challenge head on. There is no other way to deal with it. Therefore, today's conference is timely and an indication of industry's commitment towards effective and speedy delivery of the Swachh Bharat program. The objective of this conference is to ensure results on the ground by fostering partnership between the public and the corporate sector. It will require a collaborative effort from all players of society. Industry, being an important stakeholder, therefore, has an active role to play in this movement. Today, I would like to talk about two things. Firstly, I would like to highlight three reasons why industry needs to participate in the sanitation drive. Secondly, I would like to bring to the notice of everyone here the importance of behavior change required to achieve the objectives of Swachh Bharat. Merely spending money on the problem will not yield adequate results. Industry's three reasons for participation are, number one, the corporate sector in India, comprising of small, medium, and large sectors, have a huge reach. This is not just restricted to its factories, but it touches a large population through its market outreach activities. Therefore, the access that companies have to a large population of this country must be leveraged. Secondly, with the steady increase in CSR expenditure, funds and management expertise should be channelized towards sanitation. So I would urge industry to put in its best resources to solve the sanitation issue, just as they would if they had taken on a business challenge. And third, given the dearth of sanitation infrastructure in our country, from toilets to drainage systems to treatment plants for solid and liquid waste, there are a plethora of opportunities for the corporate sector. There is scope for producing innovative and scalable designs. Monitor Deloitte has estimated that the demand for rural toilets in India could be worth $10 to $12 billion. NGOs, microfinance institutions, and other corporates can play a very major role to achieve this objective. Let me now come to my second point about the need for behavioral changes. I make this point because without addressing it, our efforts and our budget allocations will not bear adequate fruit. I would like to highlight some learnings from an article published in the Economic and Political Weekly of September 2014. It is based on a survey conducted in rural North India. People in the states that have studied actually indicated a preference for open defecation. Even in households that had functioning latrines, coexistence of open defecation latrines use was as high as 45%, and government-provided latrines were often not used. Many rural households in India can afford to build the kind of inexpensive latrines that are widely used in poorer countries, but were unaware about it. A simulation model undertaken by the study predicts that 66% of households will defecate in the open, even if they received a government-constructed free latrine. The above points need to be given serious consideration by all concerned while rolling out the Swachh Bharat plans. I believe it is critical that compelling communication campaigns are done so that people are convinced about the negative impact of going to the open. The corporate sector must play an important role and use their skills to get this message across. Widespread open defecation, more so in rural India, is a human development emergency. Each year, when global figures are recomputed, India is home to a larger and larger fraction of the remaining people in the world who do not use latrines. This must now end, and I am optimistic that we have now embarked on the right path. With the Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi, himself leading this campaign, we could not have asked for more. Finally, CII has launched the Mission Sanitation in Schools last year in response to the Honorable Prime Minister's call to create provision of toilets in government schools, especially for girls. And this project is moving well. I would like to take this opportunity to assure our Honorable Minister that industry is committed to work on improving sanitation in the country. I'm confident that the three sessions planned during the day, covering all aspects of sanitation, will throw up some interesting solutions and a roadmap for the industry. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sriram. May I now invite Dr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta, President and Chief Executive, Center of Policy Research, to give his address, please.
Honorable Minister Sri Venkaiah Naidu, Mr. Ajay Sriram, I'd first like to begin by congratulating CII, and in a note of self-congratulation, the team at CPR led by Shivagato for putting together this report in record time. We hope this report will spark the kind of debate that is necessary. I think it's also worth beginning by congratulating the Government of India for making sanitation such a central element of its policy program. As Mr. Sriram said, we cannot think of an intervention that is more necessary and timely than sanitation. Almost everything that you can think of in the context of India, whether it's public health, whether it's cities, somehow that line, in a sense, runs through whether or not we can actually provide good and healthy sanitation. And frankly, sanitation, let's not mince words about it, was probably India's single biggest social failure. We talk of market failure, we talk of state failure, but the fact of the matter is we seldom talk of social failure. And the fact that the government has decided to address that kind of social failure, I think speaks volumes of its commitments. Having said that, I think we are at a very critical juncture in the sanitation debate, and I'll just make four brief points for your consideration where I think there is some cause for worry about the direction in which we are heading. Okay. The first one, and I'll say this in this forum to hopefully provoke some thought, is if you look at almost all the government initiatives over the last 5 to 10 years, one of the fundamental ways in which I think we went wrong was that we produced a deep confusion about what is the role of the public sector and what is the role of the private sector. Clearly, in an effort like this, not just the private sector, but all citizens will have to, their energies, their passions will have to be mobilized, and their talent will have to be mobilized. But what exactly is the legal, commercial, conceptual framework by which the division of labor is allocated between the public and private sector? The Honorable Minister knows this better than most of us. We tried the PPP frameworks in a whole area of activities from education to road building over the last 5 to 10 years, and those frameworks brought us to a grinding halt because they did not have clarity over what is the public sector's role and what is the private sector's role. What norms of accountability are appropriate to the public sector? What norms of accountability are appropriate to the private sector? And the big worry is that when you mix up these roles, in an optimistic scenario, you actually synergize the activities of this center, the activities of these different sections of society. But our historical experience is that when you actually try and mix up their roles, you end up doing injustice to both. You will end up holding the private sector to norms of accountability that are appropriate for the public sector, but most damagingly, you will end up creating a public sector that does not believe it is its job to do certain things. And frankly, I cannot see a sanitation architecture that does not rest upon the public sector and the state and the government saying, this is the government's responsibility. We need to build the architecture, whether it's the governance architecture, whether the human capital resources, whether the ownership structures, whether the structures of participatory governance, that can actually create this kind of, make this kind of sanitation a reality. I'm frankly deeply skeptical about this idea that the government, in a sense, arm twists and mobilizes the private sector to actually fill in gaps, right? Which ultimately will, in a sense, have to be run by the public sector. There are going to be lots of commercial opportunities for the private sector. The private sector should certainly bring it all its creative energy and talent in inventing low-cost solutions, in investing in technologies. you know, the standard kinds of ways in which private sector responds. But the idea that somehow CSR is going to be a big or central element of this, to my mind, is profoundly disturbing and profoundly misleading. And I think we need to get this relationship between the public and private exactly right, otherwise we will be in trouble. I think the second big, the second point I'd make very quickly, and this is an ordinary citizen. So we have a sanitation project, and we are now in the mission mode for building toilets. But there are lots of things happening in parallel in government, and most of us are a little bit mystified what the relationship between this mission of building toilets and sanitation and those other activities are. So just to take two examples, this government has announced, and we hope it will deliver under the Honorable Minister's leadership, a housing for all program by 2020. Right? That's a target. We also have the Right to Education Act, right? Under which a minimum infrastructure needed to be provided to all schools. Now, most ordinary citizens are wondering, if you have a housing target, if you have a school target with the minimum infrastructure target, why do you need a separate toilet target? Which other country in the world would sort of design things around toilets rather than saying there's a housing story, there's an education story, how do we embed all of these in that story? It sounds very incongruous when you say, you know, RTE has met all its school building targets. Oh, by the way, let's get CII to build some toilets in those schools. It'll sound very odd in 2020 if we have a housing for all target, right? And then we are also having a parallel discussion about toilets for all target, right? So there is actually something incongruous in the terms of way we are thinking of public finance for this, in the way in which we are actually thinking of embedding the toilet construction problem in these larger programs. Because by definition, these should not exist given the government's own objectives. So I think this is something the government will have to sort out. The third point I want to make quickly, a lot of talk has been happening about behavioral change, which is exactly right. Of course, you need behavioral change, and this has to be demand-driven ultimately. But let's not kid ourselves. There is a reason why behavioral change in India on these matters is hard. Okay? There are two conceptions of behavioral change that are, I think, at play. One very dangerous and counterproductive, and the other, I think, is somewhat muted. The dangerous and counterproductive version of behavioral changes, that this is a sociological and technical problem. Somehow you get a bunch of experts, you do some consciousness raising, you do some camps, and somehow people will change their behavior. This is sort of treating the population as infants, sort of infantile, right? They need to be educated into something. That kind of thing states are typically pretty bad at. I mean, that's not the state's comparative advantage. The real challenge in behavioral change, and I think we have to say this up front, is at some level the problem of sanitation in India is deeply connected to the problem of inequality in India. That only a society that was this hierarchical and degraded large parts of its population in the way that it did will have a problem about sanitation in this respect, right? In behavioral change, right? People don't use toilets because they don't want to clean toilets, right? That could be one hypothesis, right? Now, how do we address this problem of inequality? And I just want to sort of give one small example, I mean, you know, to highlight what I'm talking about. I happened to be in Amsterdam last week, and there was a marvelous presentation on the building of low-cost and working-class housing in 19th century Amsterdam, which faced exactly these problems, right? Sort of waste disposal, sewage, all of that stuff. You know what was striking about that discussion then in 19th century Europe? Not only did they build very imaginative low-cost housing, and all the parameters was use local materials, loose bricks, there was a special arts commission and designer for that low-cost housing, where the mandate was that just because something is for the poor, right, doesn't mean that it does not, should not have the same standards, or should not embed the same aspirations as it does for everybody else. Now, if your approach to toilet construction is going to be, there's a badly designed house, and frankly, there's no discussion of design in all of these housing for all designs. What's a functional design, right? And then you tack on a little toilet onto it, right? These interventions become a marker of that inequality. They do not induce the sense in the poor that what we are going to do is overcome that inequality. So fundamentally, you're not going to get behavioral change unless there is a transformation of that social relationship. I think that's all the comparative historical evidence is actually pointing to that. So I don't think we should pretend that behavioral change is about engineering camps through CSR. And last and final point I'll make, and just sort of end with this. One of the things this report highlights very nicely is the range of options that are available to us. And you know, I congratulate both CII and the team and the government of India for making the kind of discussion possible where we are actually thinking of, you know, different kinds of options, what kinds of interventions make sense. But there's always a danger in this sort of richness of options. And the danger is the following. India's biggest weakness across a range of activities, whether it's education, whether it's health, whether it's sanitation, is we are not very good at deciding on architectures. Our approach to reform these days is we tick off every box. Put in the public sector, put in the private sector, put in public-private partnerships, put in central government, put in local government, right? Now, at some point, the logics of these kinds of interventions is in tension with one another. And at some point, you have to make an architectural choice. Do you want centralized systems or do you want decentralized systems? Right? Do you want it to be local government ownership or do you want this to be another centrally sponsored scheme? Right? And I think, and particularly if you're talking about scaling, we will have to be very clear about what that architectural choice is. Right now, my fear is that in the rush to meet targets, there are a lot of incompatible interventions happening, right? Which are a waste of energy and a waste of resources. And I'd like to submit to the Honorable Minister, I think that in his leadership, under his leadership, we really look forward to the kind of bold and visionary decision making. That rather than just aggregating lots of little projects and meeting short-term targets, sets India onto a new pathway, right, with an internally coherent and consistent architecture, which will allow us to realize the dreams of a Swachh Bharat. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the pleasure now to announce the release of a report, Swachh Bharat, Industry Engagement, Scope and Enterprise. This report attempts to map for the first time the scope and engagement of the private sector with the Government of India's Swachh Bharat initiative. The report also includes 16 case studies of the private sector's engagement in the area of sanitation. We now have the Honorable Minister doing the honors for us. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating all concerned on the release of this report. Thank you, Honorable Minister. I now have the privilege to invite Mr. M. Venkaiah Naidu, Minister for Urban Development, Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation and Parliamentary Affairs, Government of India, to give his inaugural address. May we have the Minister, please.
Sri Ajay Sri Ramji, past President of the CAA. Sri Pratap Bhanu Mehta Ji, from the policy studies. Madam Sweta Sefari, Sefari ji, brothers and sisters who have assembled here for this consultation conference, I'm happy that the CAA has brought about a study on industry engagements, scope and examples. Friends, the India government led by our beloved Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi has brought sanitation to the forefront of the nation, because it's one area where India is very weak, often criticized, reported, highlighted. And there is no meaning in criticizing somebody for this. So we have to accept this challenge and take it forward. That's why this government has taken up this on a large scale and wanted to convert this into a people's movement. Mere government efforts alone, or even private and public sector joining together, will not suffice to make this mission successful. This has been the experience. And over the years, we politicians have made the people to think that sabkaam sarkar karega, hum bekar baithe to chalega. This sort of a mindset also has come. Because you create infrastructure, even then there is no guarantee that it will be sustainable unless people's participation is there. While creating infrastructure or architecture, whatever it is, you call it, you need to have people's consultation and people's engagement. Without that, you will not be able to really realistically reach the targets and then make them functional in future also. I take the suggestions given by Dr. Pratap Bhanu Mehta. We'll discuss them also internally within our ministry, some of these thoughts which he has thrown before us. Friends, this Swachh Bharat Mission, what is the necessity and all, I need not explain further. Much has been said and much has been written, much has been talked about. And we have the challenge of lack of toilets, lack of drinking water, lack of water connectivity to toilets, then lack of solid waste management, then methods to convert waste into energy, waste to compost. These are the two areas on which the government is focusing on long-term basis. Because waste to energy and waste to compost will be really useful. And I had three meetings with fertilizer minister and then energy minister, non-conventional energy minister, renewable energy minister. And we are about to go to the cabinet with certain proposals on these two aspects. Then with regard to the access to toilets, it's a fact that 68% or 60% of the rural India do not have access to toilets, pakka toilets. See, having a house is different. Having a house with toilet, having a school is different. Having a school with toilet. I am not talking about the future houses or the future schools. I am talking about the present situation. You have schools which do not have toilets. You have houses which do not have toilets. So we are focusing on that also. When we talk of housing for all and we are going to take up housing on a massive scale with the center and states participating and we have gone for interest subvention. Anybody, even private people, if they want to construct houses also, if they are going to avail bank loan, I am going to give 2,30,000 rupees. But toilet is mandatory. And now I have seen yesterday Chandrababu Naidu and then day for yesterday Chandrasekhar Rao and some other chief ministers also are saying that they will also match it. And the center has relaxed the rules and regulations. Earlier they used to say, no, you have to construct a house only up to this. Beyond that, then it will not be considered as an affordable house or an economically weaker section house or LIG house, and it will not be eligible for financing. I said nothing doing. Don't worry. State and center, they can join together. Size, you don't worry. You need to construct a house and also house with a toilet and also with a provision for water. So this is for the future. But now what about those houses where there are no toilets? Those schools where there are no toilets. That's why the Prime Minister last time on August 15th, he said by next August 15th, we should see to it that all the schools have toilets. Firstly, at least focus more on girl student toilets. So now the reports suggest from various states that 417,000 new toilets have been created. Creation of toilets is one thing, but using them properly and taking the responsibility is another thing. That's where the mindset also comes in. If you create a toilet without water, if you create a toilet without somebody owning it, then there will be a problem again in the schools also. So that's why we are involving various departments. It is Department of Panchayat Raj, Department of HRD, to see that the assets which we are creating are put to proper use in future also. The task before the country is enormous, enormous, and the government's resources are comparatively limited, and we have taken too many tasks on our head. Right to education, right to housing, right to sanitation, and right to so many things. Now we are taking up skill development, we are taking up poverty alleviation programs, we are taking up social security programs, all this. But jitna aata utna roti. Whatever money is available to you, only you can spend that money. So first of all, so we have to take care of the economy. The government is trying its best to take care of the economy, revive the economy, and improve the production in the country. And there are some people who are always arguing and suggesting to us that what is important, welfare is important or production is important. Without production, you cannot have welfare also. You have to produce wealth, then only you can distribute the wealth. Without producing wealth, and if you start distributing, then you will become a pauper. This is what has happened over the years also. So the government is trying to take a balanced approach, on one side creating wealth, adding to the nation's wealth, on the other side taking care of the vulnerable sections. And sanitation is one area. Yesterday, the subcommittee led by Sri Chandrababu Naidu, they have made some recommendations to have some cess dedicated for this purpose of sanitation across the country. Because state chief ministers have joined together and made a recommendation, I hope that there will be at least support from all the states in the future. When this cess idea came, when Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee started this national highway program, many people criticized it, saying that what it is, you are going to put 50 paise cess on petrol, 50 paise on diesel, and then how many toll gates will be there and all. But after that, you have seen in this, in his period of Vajpayee, this connectivity, it has become really a revolution, and it has added to the nation's wealth and also to the comfort. And nobody is complaining on that count. Of course, if there is excess toll correction, that's a different issue. But once the amount is realized, then the toll has to be removed. But you are able to create infrastructure, at least on the national highways. And also, you had a rural road program, Pradhan Mantri Gramin Sadak Yojana. So it's always in the interest of the people that the people also are made to participate by making them to understand what the government intend to do. In the coming days, friends, the Prime Minister told me one thing. This Swachh Bharat will succeed, provided it is made into a people's movement, Jana Andolan. That's why we are seeking the support of all people. One is the changing of the mindset, creating the infrastructure, and then taking care to see that the infrastructure is sustained by better maintenance. We have a three-pronged approach. One, changing the mindset, creating awareness. If minister says something, some people may take that advice. If an icon of any segment of society says something, there will be larger acceptance also. So along with the government, center, state and urban local bodies, we are engaging icons from society also to propagate the need for Swachh Bharat and cleanliness. That is paying dividends to some extent. We have only made a beginning. There are some critics who are saying 1 year is over, this is lacking. I'm happy that they are highlighting it. But at least now something is happening. And in a country like India, where you have 120 crore population, 68% without toilets in the rural areas, you can't expect them to change overnight and government to do everything that is possible. If it is so simple and easy, the governments which were there in power all these years, they would have done it long back. But this government have made a beginning. So this started yielding results. I had a meeting with the Honorable Rashtrapati where 140 these Swachh Bharat ambassadors were there. We had some exchange of ideas, etc. Some impact is being felt, but it need to be pushed up further. That's why yesterday we had a meeting of 12 ministries and all senior ministers. We sat together, and in the coming days, we have decided to re-energize this Swachh Bharat mission further and take it forward. We have a three-pronged approach. One, as I told you, changing the mindset. not only asking them to go to toilet, but maintaining it, keeping the premises clean. Apna makan, apna dukan, apna parivar, apna mandir, apna masjid, apna gurudwara, wahan bhi. They should all come together and then see to it that is maintained. If you leave everything to government, there are 50,000 Safai Karmacharis in Delhi, for information. All the three corporations put together. But you know what is happening. Because there is no accountability. So we have to think in terms of people's participation at every level, at ward level, at residential welfare associations also, at the panchayat level, at the district level. There has to be frequent review and then frequent frequent exchange of ideas so that you can move faster. Second is about creating infrastructure. If you start, people are suggesting to me, sir, no, you must go for Singapore model, you must find the people. People are doing that, people are doing this, they are not caring for cleanliness and all. You don't create toilets and you punish them to going for urinal in a public place. How can these two things go together? A person comes from Rajasthan, goes to Connaught Place, and then suddenly he has to go for urination, and you say, you don't create the public urinals there, and then if he goes for urination in a public place, then you penalize him, then he will penalize you tomorrow, and then when an occasion comes to him. So we have to create the infrastructure. That's why the government is totally committed to see that the necessary infrastructure for toilets, for solid waste management, for sanitation, even parking in urban areas, all these things are taken care. And then you have to follow it up by a regulation also. Yesterday, the NDMC chairman was telling me, I was inquiring with him, by what about parking in the Connaught Place area? He said, sir, there are two multi-level parking areas, only 20% is occupied. There is some resistance, where the resistance from the people and all. My point is create infrastructure, then have regulation. Then you take action against the people. If you don't have infrastructure, you can't even think of taking action. I met the Singapore Prime Minister sometime back. He was telling me, Mr. Naidu, ours is a fine city. I was thinking it's a fine city and also fines city also. But in India, as I told you, if you have to do the Singapore model, you know this country's position as on now. So, focus is more on creating infrastructure. The infrastructure challenge also is very big. What are the amounts available with me? What is the budget allocation of the center and state governments? And if I don't at least guide and then formulate a scheme and give it to the states, there is a problem, I can tell you. Some people started questioning and Vajpayee ji started Pradhan Mantri Gramin Sadak Yojana. Some CM said, is it for Delhi to think about road in a village? I said, certainly not. Then why are you taking up? Because I told him, because you have not taken up in the last 60 years. It forced a prime minister to think about village road. If I give a grant lump sum amount, and then leave it to the states. You know what is happening in states. I am not critical about anybody, but realistic. Some of the states are engaged in giving Mangala Sutra. Mangala Sutra is given by the other side, to my knowledge. And some people are giving mixie, grinder. I am not against giving mixie, grinder. You can give hair dye also. I have no problem. Problem is, where is the money? You don't have minimum infrastructure, sanitation, drinking water, and then toilets, you don't have rural roads, you don't have electricity to many places, but money is being spent. That's why the center at least designing certain schemes, and then we are giving the flexibility to the states to make the changes. I told you just about the housing also. I can tell you the fact about this, the 14th Finance Commission has devolved 42% of the central funds to states. Many of us in the cabinet told the Prime Minister, what is happening, sir? Earlier it used to be 1%, 2% increase, you want to increase 10%. He said, yes, it should be given. Then I said, they will take it in the evening and next day morning they will forget. He said, I was the Chief Minister for 13 years, I know. There has to be flexibility for the states, and states know better what is more important, what is required. That's why this 42% to states and 5% to urban local bodies and then 2% to natural calamities and then some other amount for other purposes. 49.50% of the central revenue is given to states and to the local bodies now so that they can leverage these funds. And flexibility is always given, even the so-called smart cities, Amrut also. Whatever amount I am giving, I am allowing the states to use it as a seed money and borrow money and then create the needed infrastructure also. That's why we are trying to be flexible and we are trying to accommodate the state's point of view. At the same time, you know, in this competitive politics, nowadays there is a competition everywhere. People want everything to be done by center and at the same time they don't want center to do anything. The other day they were saying, why 50-50, make it 90-10, 90% center government and 10% state government. Then on the one hand, you say center should not get into these things also. Friends, what I am trying to say is that we need to spend around 2 lakh crores over the next 5 years in rural and urban areas to create minimum infrastructure with regard to sanitation. About 62,000 crores is to be spent in my 4,041 cities in urban areas, 62,000 crores. And then assistance to individual house toilets, what is required is 1.04 crores. 2.52 lakh community toilets and 2.56 lakh public toilets also are the need of the hour. Over 30 crore urban residents will be given assistance in solid waste management also. We promote projects through PPP model by states and urban local bodies. Swachh Bharat Kosh has been given, provided to have tax and fiscal incentives. Corporate social responsibility is one of the additional factors that has been taken up. We have had an ambitious program. 25 lakh individual household was supposed to be constructed by 2016. But so far only 4 lakhs have been completed and 12 lakhs are in progress. And out of 78,000 municipal wards in our country, 29,000 wards have the door-to-door collection of garbage system. But remaining area, we need to reach that also. And that's why, keeping all these things in mind, we have kept this cleanliness, Swachh Bharat, sanitation as an essential element of the Smart City Mission, Amrut Mission, Hruday Scheme, and also all these schemes are complementary to each other. And then we are willing to work along with the states and we have to work with the states. That is the mandate given to us. The Prime Minister also is very clear that we have to take the states along with us and we go ahead with this. The idea is by 2019, we need to incur around 8.93 lakh crores totally on all these sectors. This money has to be mobilized, one, by the government, two, by the state, third, by urban local bodies, fourth, by the PPP model, public-private partnership. And we have to change the mindset of the people also. I am sure if you motivate them and if you bring transparency, people will be willing to pay. You are providing them some service. You are providing them water regular. You are providing them current regularly. Then you can ask people to pay. If you don't pay regularly, then they will not be willing to pay regularly also. Some people are worried. The urban governance I have seen across the country, nobody want to levy any charge or extra charge. Nobody want to increase any tax, because if you increase tax, then you will be axed tomorrow. That's the fear. And that's why many of the mayors and all, they think, achha ho gaya, hamara term pura ho gaya, aadmi achha hai, badiya aadmi hai, kuch kiya nahi, kuch tax bhi dala nahi, ho gaya unka kaam, badiya aadmi. इससे कोई फायदा नहीं है. दैट्स वाई द अदर डे आई सेड, इफ स्मार्ट सिटीज नीड स्मार्ट लीडरशिप, नॉट इन टर्म्स ऑफ स्मार्टनेस मीन्स हाइट वेट कोट बूट सूट हैट, इन टर्म्स ऑफ विजन, इन टर्म्स ऑफ एग्जीक्यूशन, इन टर्म्स ऑफ टेकिंग बोल्ड डिसीजंस, वी नीड सच अर्बन लीडरशिप. इवन इफ यू वॉन्ट दिस सैनिटेशन प्रोग्राम ऑल्सो टू बी सक्सेसफुल, दैट हैज़ टू बी टेकन केयर. एज आई टोल्ड यू, वी आर ऑल कंपीटिंग विथ पॉपुलिज्म. पीपल आर सेइंग फ्री पावर. I always have a very strong view on this free power business. Free power means first low power, then no power. No power is free power only. If there is no power, then you can say, yes, I am giving free power. There is a wrong conception, if you levy charges, people will react and all. I have the example of Gujarat. 13 years our Prime Minister was Chief Minister. There is no free power in Gujarat. But still elected him thrice. And not only that, he organized lakhs of raids on unauthorized users of the power. But still, people elected him back. So your point is, if you have transparent system, if you are involving people in decision making, people participation is there, people will be willing to provide, to pay the user charges. Without user charges, I don't think, I'm not saying it simply because I have become urban development minister. Earlier I was rural development minister also. From rural I came to urban, like any other people. All others are now coming because of education, employment, entertainment, economic activity, enhanced medical facilities are available in urban area. That's why everybody is migrating for that. I have not migrated for that purpose. Prime Minister has given me this responsibility. That's why I'm in this job. The point is, you have to create this infrastructure. The first infrastructure is sanitation. For that also, as I told you, you can't expect the entire thing to be borne by the government of India. The finance minister was asking me, Venkaiah, you are saying give this concession, that concession, this concession. He said, I will do everything what you say. But at the same time, tell me where I have to levy tax and get that extra amount. Somewhere he has to collect and then give it to us. So keeping this in mind, a great debate has to be there across the country, and then people at the end of the day, but they must be made sure to stand, think that this thing, system is transparent, this money is collected, this is spent for this purpose, and people have got a right to know in between. That's why a lot of reforms are going to take place in urban areas. Friends, coming back to this sanitation campaign, yesterday and we met, we have identified to undertake 11 theme-based sanitation campaigns in urban areas as below. One is United Clean India Drive will be taken up from 11th October till 31st October, which is the birth anniversary of late Sardar Patel. During this period, focus will be on cleanliness drive in transportation sector, including railways, metros, bus stands, airport, taxi stands, since transport networks connect unite all. Second, agriculture mandis, vegetable, grain markets would be the focus of cleanliness drive during November 1st to 15th. The third one is religious places, tourism, heritage, because large people congregate there, would be the target during November 16th to 30th. Education institutions will focus on sanitation from December 1st to December 15th. Resident welfare associations would be undertaking intensive cleanliness drive during the period 16th to 31st December. Cleanliness would be ensured at the underpasses, areas under flyovers and main roads during January 1st and 15th. Contournment boards would focus on sanitation efforts during January 16th to 31st. Municipal corporation would focus on cleanliness in water bodies, recreation parks, play and rest areas during 1st to 15th February. Hospitals and health centers, institutions would be do so during February 16th to 28th. Cleanliness drive would be undertaken in old cities and main markets during 1st to 15th March. All government offices, buildings and other public institutions would be focusing on sanitation drive during March 16th to 31st. It does not mean only those 15 days, those departments, that will be focused attention. Because that focused themes which we have awarded is to make them to understand that every sector needs cleanliness, and every department also has been given some time frame. Otherwise, yesterday we have decided this is a program started last year on October 2nd, and this program will continue up to 2019, and that will become thereafter as part of the people's life, because this sanitation and the cleanliness is a daily activity. It's like your beard. You shave your beard today, whether you like it or not, by tomorrow it will come back. And if you say, no, I have shaved it yesterday, I will shave it only next October 2nd, then you will become a sadhu. Sadhu, you may not be sadhu, but you will have a dadi at least, along with your body. So this has to be a regular affair. So it has to become a part of our regular life. One, through change of behavioral change. Two, by creating the necessary infrastructure. And third, by highlighting the good examples. Certain media groups are really doing a good job of highlighting what are the success stories, highlighting what are the failures. This is also required. I don't want the media to focus only on success stories and give goody-goody picture and do not focus on other side. It is also required, that will be a reminder to the administration at various levels to see that this is lacking and that they have to focus on this. This is another area in which I seek the cooperation of the media and also the other people. Coming to the mission, The mission idea is transforming India into a totally sanitized, healthy and livable country, eliminating open defecation, eradication of manual scavenging, prevention of pollution of water sources, ensuring cleanliness and hygiene in public places, awareness creation and capacity building, scientific disposal of waste sewage to achieve zero discharge of pollution in water bodies, and behavioral changes for Swachh Bharat through a national level campaign. This is the mission of Swachh Bharat. And this used to be part of our life in the olden days, but in between so-called civilization and all, then these things also has come into our life. So we have to take seriously this mission. Tanse manse dhanse bhi. We have tanu mana dhanse. Hum sab log isme bhagidari hona chahiye. I see that industry also has an important role. I only suggest to CAA, ASSOCHAM, FICCI, Punjab, Haryana, Delhi Chamber of Commerce and all. I don't say it's mandatory, but at the same time, you are a big organization. You also have a social responsibility. In your own way, you must also have good targets and try to focus and join that, reach those targets also. That is what is required. Otherwise, simply holding a seminar or a meeting and then giving some ideas is always good, because ideas are required. Everybody should learn, including ministers. Ministers also should learn, not yarn. Learn has to be there. And we also learn by experiences. I learned certain new ideas by Pratap Bhanu Mehtaji's exposition, what she made today. Some ideas have come to my mind. I will discuss. Iske upar kuch vichar manthan hoga, utna kitna sambhav hai, kitna practical hai, wo kitna acceptable hoga. Jarur iske upar vichar manthan hona chahiye. New ideas, new technology, new ideas also are very much required. You can't go on what was relevant 30 years back, 40 years back, may not be relevant today. I remember as a student, I used to shout, automation, anti-nation. As a student, we used to oppose computerization in banks. Can we say it today? Things have changed. So similarly, technologies also, new technologies have come now. New technologies have come. So we have to take advantage of this new technologies also. And then people also have seen, the other day I was telling a story, one Dr. Padmavati and Prasad, two couples in Challapalli, one village in Krishna district of Andhra Pradesh, someone informed me, later I got it confirmed. They have been doing this cleanliness campaign every day, morning 4:30 to 6, using lights in their village continuously to keep their village clean, along with other local civic body people. Continuously, from October 2nd last year, when the PM has launched this program. So there are many examples. I saw Ramakrishna Math also doing a great job the other day in Mangalore. The Swamiji's met and then gave me what they are doing and all. There are a lot of thousands and but thousands of alone will not suffer. You need lakhs and crores of examples like that, because the country is very big. So that's where the role of the organizations like CAA, they have a greater responsibility in this. I am not trying to pass on the responsibility to them. We will do our responsibility. At the same time, as part of the social responsibility, these bodies also should take up this cleanliness drive, starting with their own offices, with their own premises, and then the neighborhood also. They can also adopt certain villages, they can also adopt certain areas also, so that there is some guardian to that area who is overseeing it and all. People will definitely be happy to invite such people. So we need to have a national level mission. We are having state level missions, they are created. City level missions, we have told them every city is supposed to finalize a city Swachh plan, and then we will also be identifying what are the clean cities. There will be competition among the cities. What are the clean towns? There will be competition among the towns. What are the clean panchayats? There will be competition among panchayats. What are the clean hospitals? There will be competition. The other day, Health Minister was telling me they are going to reward 5 crore rupees for the best hospital at the national level, state level. These are all the ways to motivate people and also have some sort of competition. Railways, they are also changing the present toilets into biodigest toilets. That's 4,500 racks have been already changed. But railways have some 45,000 racks or so. It's a huge responsibility, but yesterday Railway Board Chairman told us, sir, in the coming three and a half years, the railways will change all the toilets, because you see in railway, and the railway line also, such an ugly situation. And even the railway stations also, the railways have taken it as a program to see that the railway stations are kept clean, and they are going to take up, they are taking up already a program in railway stations. Similarly, airports. Airports are comparatively better because less people go to airport and then rich people maintain those airports. But at the same time, the bus stands, the mandis, the markets, the other public places, everywhere there is a need for, to have sanitation. So this awareness, as I told you in the beginning, is the need of the hour. I'm happy through these discussions, greater awareness is being created. I hope that these organizations will take some more interest to get themselves involved in this campaign. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, Mr. Naidu. As a token of appreciation for the efforts made by CII and CPR towards Swachh Bharat Mission, on behalf of the Government of India, may I request the Honorable Minister to hand over a memento to Mr. Ajay Sriram and Dr. Mehta, please. And now may I request Mr. Ajay Sriram to give the closing remarks, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've had a very interesting session today and had the privilege of hearing Honorable Minister and Dr. Mehta share their thoughts with us. I think Dr. Mehta always comes out with really fresh thinking, out-of-the-box thinking, and that's, I think, what is always needed when we have to revisit any program and take it forward. I think his approach towards accountability, I think, is the most important point which has to be taken up at every level to actually get results. Otherwise, we get stuck in terms of just doing the action without getting the result. So I think that's very clear. And also, I really appreciate his focus on systems and processes. That really is the name of the game. Unless that's really clearly articulated and accountability is clearly articulated, we won't get the result. So I think that's really critical. We had the privilege also of the minister sharing his thoughts. So as you rightly said, it is a people's movement. Unless everyone gets involved, it can't move forward. And the responsibility at the end of the day has to be taken by the house owner or the school principal or whoever's involved. It cannot be the government nor the corporate sector. They have to take it up. So it has to be a people's movement. Mindset change is critical, which was mentioned by both our speakers. It is so important to actually change the mindset to make sure that people really want it and accept it at the end of the day. Sir, what you mentioned of creating infrastructure, it's very true. Have regulations is very true. But I think the challenge always is enforcing regulation. I think that is where there has to be, to my mind, whether it's a company or whether it's a country, there has to be a bit of a danda. Otherwise, it won't work. You know, I think that's a necessity. So I think there has to be a little fear of the law and fair implementation of the law, which is important to ensure that whatever policy is brought about is implemented. I think what you mentioned about people's paying for infrastructure or for any facility, absolutely essential. It can't be a social service indefinitely. People have to pay for a benefit they're getting. And I believe that if a person gets a service at whatever level, in a village, in a tier 3, tier 2 town, they are happy to pay provided they get that service. So I think it's a mutual agreement which has to be worked out and providing that service. The 11 themes you talked about, Minister, are very important and very critical, and I'm sure we'll also work with you to carry that forward. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, thank you, Honorable Minister. Thank you very much for coming and sharing your thoughts with us. Dr. Mehta, thank you so much for coming and sharing your thoughts with us. I'd like to thank the media also for being here with us today. I'd like to thank all of you for coming and being here at the session. And I'm sure the balanced deliberations, the deliberations at the rest of the day will be very productive and forward-looking and will add value to how we carry this entire Swachh Bharat program forward. Thank you.